Have you heard of number needed to treat? And do you understand that how by loosening criteria for making people eligible for statin therapy, that actually makes the therapy less effective rather than more effective in terms of that number? In this video, I'll explain how it's not in the best interest of the pharmaceutical companies to improve the number needed to treat, and how when it comes to statins, the mainstream medical community seems to have lost sight of us as individuals and is treating us as a giant clinical study. Stand by. Before I get into it, I just want to make it perfectly clear that I am not anti-medical establishment. I'm not actually anti-medication. I just think that in the particular case of statins, both the pharmaceutical companies and the medical profession seems to have kind of strayed off the straight path to what's best for us. In this particular video, I'm going to be speculating quite a bit on why I think that's so, and please understand that it is my personal speculations. So the number needed to treat, that's the number of people who must be given a particular treatment in order for one of them to benefit. And that's easily calculated. It's the number needed to treat is 1 divided by the absolute risk reduction. Now, I talked about risk reduction. I talked about how risk reduction is actually requires a context for it to have any meaning. So why, given that it is just the reciprocal of it, do we use it? Well, when you have a number like, 2% or 4% or 4.3%, those low numbers, they really don't strike us meaningfully. Whereas the number needed to treat gives us a number like, well, I'll demonstrate here. If the absolute risk reduction for a group to be treated is 8%, then the number needed to treat is 12.5. In other words, we have to treat 12.5 people on average. I mean, obviously we're not going to treat half a person, but over large numbers, we're going to treat 12.5 people for everyone who's going to benefit. To me, that doesn't sound like a really good treatment. There's so many people who have to carry the burden of the treatment with no benefit from it. So like I said earlier, the number needed to treat has the same problems as the absolute risk reduction. You do have to put it in the context. You have to understand what went into saying the number needed to treat. Well, number needed to treat for a high risk group may be very different than the number needed to treat for a low risk group, and I'm going to actually get into that. Here's where I'm really going to be speculating. We're going to get into a large thought experiment. And what we're going to do is we're going to consider 100 people with a 22% risk of a cardiovascular event over 10 years. Now, in this thought experiment, I'm using the same assumptions that I actually used when I was talking about absolute risk reduction and relative risk reduction. That is that the relative risk reduction is the same over all risk levels, and that we know what the risk level is. So we're just going to grant those just for simplification and to be as generous as we can to the pharmaceutical companies. So if we represented this group of 100 people with a 22% risk as this diagram, you'll see that 78 of them, that's the other 78%, the ones represented in yellow, aren't going to have a cardiovascular event with or without treatment. They're not going to have the heart attack. And the people in green are the ones who will essentially be saved from a heart attack or any cardiovascular event if they're treated. And the red people are the ones who are just going to have the event regardless of whether they're treated or not. And this is the circumstance where the number needed to treat is 12.5. So just look at that diagram for a while and say, wow, that's the people we're actually helping, the green dots there. And the red dots we're probably hurting in the sense that people may have a false sense of security, they're going to be helped by this treatment, and they're not. And of course, we don't know who's who, and that's part of the problem. Continuing on with this thought experiment, how can we improve the number needed to treat? Well, let's consider different ways that it could be improved. This is an idealistic world. We're going to assume that we can get everything to perfection. Suppose we perfected the effectiveness of the treatment for those people who are having heart attacks. In other words, this diagram here where we have the 78 yellow dots and the 8 green dots, those other 14 red dots, suppose we could make them green. In other words, increase the effectiveness of this sort of therapy so that everybody who is going to have a heart attack actually benefits from it. Well, if we could do that, the editorial we, the medical community, the pharmaceutical companies, society in general, whatever. If that could be done, then the number needed to treat is 4.5. But here's a case where the context is actually a little different, because that 4.5 number needed to treat is actually better than 4.5 in another context, because in this case, nobody is left out. A bunch of people are taking a therapy that they turn out not to need, but at least there's nobody taking the therapy and still having a heart attack from it. Now, there could be a scenario we could put together where the number needed to treat to benefit one was 4.5, but there's still a person in there, you know, one of the other 3.5 people is still going to have a heart attack or something like that. If you get my meaning, that the number, that's kind of one of the issues with number needed to treat, because it doesn't have its full context with it. But with that caveat, let's continue on. Well, suppose instead we were to perfect our risk knowledge, and then somehow, instead of, like, say we found we just can't perfect the effectiveness any more than it is. It's 36% of the people who are going to have heart attacks are going to be saved with the therapy. The rest aren't. But if we could perfect our risk knowledge and we could divide this group, we think it's 22%, this group of 100 people, 22% of them are going to have heart attacks. Well, suppose somehow we could actually say, well, here's the 78 who aren't going to have a heart attack, and here's the 22 that are going to have a heart attack. In other words, we improve through knowledge the understanding of what leads somebody to have a heart attack. If we could do that, then the number needed to treat is 2.7. Well, why 2.7? Well, we're not going to treat the 78 people who don't have a heart attack in their future, and we are going to treat the people who do have a heart attack in their future. And that 2.7 is actually the reciprocal of 36%. And if we could combine both, well, then it's fantastic, because then we could actually divide this into this group of 100 into the two groups, the 78 who aren't going to have a problem and the 22 RR, and we're going to save those 22. In that case, our number needed to treat is 1. Now, like I've said before, that may sound like a pipe dream, pie in the sky stuff, and maybe for heart attacks it is, but it's not unknown in the medical field, because this is exactly what happens with say, a rabies treatment. We don't treat people who are at no risk, haven't been exposed to rabies, but we do treat people who have been exposed to rabies, and we save virtually everyone. And if we don't treat them, well, they're going to be a red dot. So now we're going to add just a little twist to make this a little bit more realistic. Let's suppose, like I had said in an earlier video, that it's likely that the risk value is a combination of our lack of perfect knowledge and residual random effect. And say we do more and more studies, we get a better idea of what causes somebody to be susceptible to a heart attack, but we can't do it perfectly. But we're able to break the 100 people into two groups. In one group, there's 76 people, and 4 people have slipped past our filter, and they're, if left untreated, are going to have a heart attack. And if we were to treat them, on average, 1.4 of the 76, 14 of 760, whatever, would be helped with a treatment. Well, the number needed to treat is 54. Now, this is a cold calculus. We could look at that and say, we're not going to treat them, and we are going to bear the cost of the fact that 4 people are going to have a heart attack. Well, good for us, but not good for the people who have the heart attack. So just keep that in mind. You know, sometimes the numbers can't really tell us what is the right decision. Life values enter into it. So in the other group of the remaining 24, well, 18 of them actually are at risk for a heart attack. So in other words, 6 people kind of slip through the net, so to speak, and end up in that group, even though they're not going to have a heart attack. We're in that group that we think that they're at a high risk of a heart attack. And the number needed to treat then is 3.7, because 6.5 of 24 people on average, again, you're not going to save half a person, but you know what I mean. The number needed to treat there is 3.7. So in looking at these two groups, well, it makes a lot more sense to definitely treat that 3.7. And that 54, well, then we have kind of the ethical questions of, do we make everybody carry the burden of that treatment in order to save, you know, such a small percent, 1 out of 54 people? Question I can't answer directly. I mean, I have an answer for it, but it may not be your answer, and that doesn't mean you're wrong. So I'm going to describe what I call the big tent approach. And the big tent approach is where we have a standard of care, and then the standard of care gets broadened or loosened so that more people will become eligible for statin therapy. Now, usually what will happen when a new standard of care comes out, one of two things. It will be broadened, which will bring in more people under the umbrella of statin users. Or if the standard tightens things up and says, no, there's fewer people should be on statins, and then they're going to get a lot of criticism from the other side, whatever the other side is, that says, hey, you've reduced the number of people on statins. We should be increasing the number of people on statins. And believe me, I've seen a lot of that just looking around at different articles and medical journals. There are people who think that almost everybody should be on a statin. So that's the political context under which we're working, though. So I'm going to just give a for instance. I just pick numbers for illustration purposes. These aren't numbers that are from a study or anything like that. I'm just showing you how it works. So suppose we have 1 million patients, and they each have a greater than 10% or 10% or greater risk of a cardiovascular event over the next 10 years. Their average is 25% because they're not all at 10%. Some are at 50%, some are at 60%, some are at 40%. But we're going to just guess that their average is 25%. So out of those 1 million patients, 250,000 of them, if they're left untreated, are going to have a cardiovascular event. Well, that's a major public health crisis right there. You know, when you say 25%, it doesn't seem so big. But when you say but 1 million people and 250,000 are going to have heart attacks, it seems pretty big. And if we put them on statin therapy, we're going to grant the statins the relative risk reduction that was advertised. This is a generous thing to do, but we're just going to do it just to see where it brings us. And 90,000 heart attacks will be avoided, or cardiovascular events will be avoided. So the number needed to treat is just over 11. So in other words, we have to treat 11 people to save one of those people. So the numbers add up. I mean, 90,000 is an overwhelming number, but it's still one out of 11. So just keep that in mind. This is where it becomes a difficult ethical problem to trade off one side versus the other, because the numbers are huge and the numbers are larger than we would want them on the other side. So now suppose a new standard of care comes out and they say, you know, we're going to drop the level to a 5% chance of a heart attack. And say they do that, and that doubles the pool of patients. In other words, it brings in another 1 million people, because the lower the heart attack risk, the larger the group seemed to become, and the more people we're going to bring in. So that's going to say it just doubles it. So we have 1 million new patients, and their average risk is 7.5% because they're between 5 and 10. So we're just going to take it in the middle and say 7.5%. What are those 1 million patients? 75,000 cardiovascular events are occurring in that group. And if we put them on statin therapy, 27,000 events will be avoided. Another large number. But the number needed to treat is up to 37. It's for that group, for that 1 million people. Now, if we add the two groups together and say 2 million people, we're going to save however many, 117,000 cardiovascular events, I guess it is. The total number needed to treat has just gone from 11 up to 17. So in a sense, this treatment is less and less effective. A smaller and smaller portion of people are being helped by it. So let's just keep that in mind. So let's look at the motivations to improve the number needed to treat. So first, let's look at the pharmaceutical companies. Well, does the pharmaceutical company have a motivation to improve the effectiveness of their product in order to reduce the number needed to treat? Well, I think they actually do, because if they could improve the number needed to treat through the effectiveness of the product, meaning that the relative risk reduction would increase up towards 100%, if they could do that, they've got a competitive advantage over, you know, the other companies. Unfortunately, I think they're just up against the biological realities of it, and I don't think they can improve it anymore. Are they motivated to improve the number needed to treat by improving, helping us improve, giving us the information it takes to improve the predictability of the, you know, the risk levels? They actually don't. That goes counter to their interests, because that would mean we're more likely to identify a group of people who were eligible for statins who aren't going to be treated anymore. In other words, decrease the customer base. They have no motivation to do that. They want more and more people on statins. So now let's look at the medical community. I think there's well-intentioned efforts to make more patients eligible. because in real numbers, that theoretically saves more people. So when you have a doctor who's coming out and saying statins are overprescribed, he catches a lot of flack from the mainstream medical community saying you're going to cost people lives. And in a real sense, you could probably statistically justify that position. But it increases the number needed to treat, and you got to ask, how high do we allow that to go? And more importantly, do we inform patients of what it is? Because I bet even with the current standards, if you told a patient, you know, there's only a 1 in 5 chance that this is going to save you from a heart attack, they're probably going to have a lot of serious questions. They might still take the treatment, but hopefully they're going to try finding other ways to further reduce their risk of a heart attack. If you told them, well, there's a 1 in 10 chance this is going to help you, then they're going to have some serious thoughts about, is it worth going through this therapy? So what happens is we get the law of diminishing returns. You get fewer and fewer people who are going to be saved with each new group of people who are put under therapy. Now, there's a related concept called the number needed to harm, and you want this number to be as high as possible. So in other words, if the number needed to harm is 100, that means you could treat 100 people and then one of them may have bad side effects. The problems with the number needed to harm is there are contextual problems here too. How do you even define harm? Is harm somebody gets rhabdomyolysis, I think that's how it's pronounced, where basically their muscles get poisoned and they actually could die from it? Is that the only side effect? Well, that's very rare. So the number needed to harm in terms of that particular side effect is actually quite high. It's really bad show for the people who that happens to. But there's a lot of other harms, and I think doctors downplay. They definitely downplay patient reports of adverse effects. And those doctors who are doing that, those doctors who kept on telling me, for example, oh, you're just getting old, or no, that's not a known side effect, so we're not going to report it because it's not a known side effect. And I scratch my head and I say, well, the reason it's not a known side effect is because you doctors are refusing to report it when a patient's saying this is happening to them. Those doctors who downplay their patients' concerns, they've got to take a deep look into their own consciences and ask themselves whether they really belong in the medical profession. So I'll have a lot more to say about the number needed to harm in future videos. I'll just say that I believe that number is way too low right now, and it's a lot lower than the mainstream medical profession is admitting to. There are a lot of hidden harms that a patient might not complain about. A patient might not realize, like I went 10 years without realizing that I was having these side effects from statins. So as usual, here are the 5 things that you can do to help out the channel. Like the video, comment, tell me what things you would like me to discuss, share it with other people who may benefit from it, and then of course the one-time things are subscribe and hit the notification bell. And if you haven't seen this video, I suggest you take a look at it now. Thanks.